reasons why we've chosen startups to present to you. So all the time we meet interesting people, we are more than happy. And probably the same should be all the participants. All right, then I'll start by presenting Florian and Caterina. I'll let them say a couple of words, starting with Florian and then Caterina. And afterwards, Florian will have the floor and we'll start the presentation. Please, Florian.
Yeah, hi, I'm Florian. I'm co-founder and CEO of Fretello, music learning startup based right out of Austria, and happy to be here to present my startup and the great opportunity to your network.
Please, Caterina.
Hi, everyone. I'm Kadeva Santiku. I'm the founder and managing director of Workathlon. We're a hospitality recruitment software. We're based in Athens, Greece. And I know a lot of you love Greece. And we're headquartered in the UK. And we're really excited to be here. So looking forward to the pitch and the Q&A.
Okay, thanks a lot to both of you. You have the floor, Florian.
Okay, I'm sharing my screen. Okay, can you see the slides?
Yeah.
Cool. So yeah, Fretello, we are all about learning, mastering, and playing a musical instrument, and in particular, that's the guitar. So whenever or if ever you try to learn to play something by yourself, you probably figured out it can be hard, and learning how to play the guitar is really hard. It's overwhelming, it can be intimidating, and that's also the reason why 90% of all guitar players quit playing the guitar within the first 3 months, within the first 90 days. The interesting part here is they quit after making a significant investment because they already purchased a guitar, which costs a couple of hundred euros. And this is an issue I personally faced because most people end up searching YouTube for tutorials, get started, learn to play a few chords, get frustrated because they figure out it's hard and they don't make any progress. And there's a reason for that, why people don't make a progress, and that's what we address. The main reason is you need a systematic approach to progress. You need a didactical, pedagogical approach to progress. And the second thing is you need feedback. You need the invaluable feedback of a guitar teacher, ideally, but not everybody has access to a guitar teacher. And that's why we set out on a mission to create an inviting digital music learning experience that really empowers people to play the guitar. So we're not talking about a game like Color by Numbers or something where people just learn to play note after note. For us, it's really important to make music education, high quality music education, more accessible, and help people to learn and master their musical instrument. As of today, we are the only music learning software on the market that's capable of providing a fully immersive learning experience. So we provide our users with immediate feedback when they play and help them to recover from their mistakes. So the way you can imagine this is people sit in front of their monitors, of their smartphones or tablets, see themselves in a mirror through the front-facing camera, and we're using augmented reality to directly show people where to put your fingers. We use the microphone of the smartphone to analyze where they make mistakes, provide them with tips how to overcome these mistakes. So this is usually feedback that only a good guitar teacher can provide in a personal session as of today. So the question is, are we replacing the guitar teacher? No, we're not. We're actually complementing them and augmenting them. So a lot of our customers are also guitar teachers who use our solution for their students. Because if you think of it, for a guitar lesson, you probably have one lesson once a week. And for the other 6 days, the student is left home alone without any feedback. So we're actually also helping guitar teachers providing more feedback. So our approach is to be guiding, to provide a didactical approach to be supportive, so to provide feedback to the users, and to be also attainable and affordable, because music education is expensive, and we see a lot of people, like, they can afford a guitar, but they can't afford music lessons for $60 or euros a week. So this is also one of our key promises, to make music education more accessible throughout the whole world. As already mentioned, we're doing that with a digital product, which is the Fretello app. And we are basically combining comprehensive music education. So all our learning content is created in collaboration with certified music teachers with less than 100 years of teaching experience in total, and in-depth feedback. And thereby, I mean, we're using machine learning to analyze how users play, to provide them with information. So whatever a music teacher can hear, our algorithms are capable of understanding as well. And we can actually provide the same quality feedback that a teacher can provide in a personal lesson. So the interesting part here is, since we build our technology stack on machine learning, it basically works with any instrument. We started with the guitar because it's the biggest market, but we have already proof of concept that we can easily port it to piano, to woodwind instruments or drums. So we're quite flexible compared to other solutions, which are using traditional signal processing methods. While the first version of the technology was created in collaboration with the leading research institute for music information retrieval, our startup owns the entire IP. So whatever we develop is created in-house. We have our own R&D team. So we have a significant advantage compared to others who are just licensing tools or algorithms from universities. So we are building everything in-house. We own the technology, so that's a huge thing for us, basically. A little bit about traction. So we are a subscription business, and we basically have reached product market fit. So we are outperforming other learning applications, especially from the language learning sector, where we are seeing strong correlations in terms of retention. So 4% of all the users who install the app are still active 30 days after installing our app. And every third user, and this number is currently rising, converts from a free trial. So we are premium products. To access the educational content, you have to start a subscription. You can try it for free, but in the end, you have to pay. And the really interesting part here is 9 out of 10 of our subscribers commit to annual subscriptions. So we see very good LTVs compared to other products in the music learning, or general in the learning B2C market. So we have extremely good LTVs. We have a comparably low churn rate. So we see good retention, good renewals, making it a growing and growable business. Bringing me to growth drivers. So what's actually causing the growth? First and foremost, it's continuing content releases. So we're continuously improving our learning offering, releasing new content, giving people and musicians all kinds of tastes are different, the opportunity to explore different genres, like from blues to heavy metal. We're actively working with partners. So we figured out 50% of all guitar purchases every year come from beginners. So they buy their first guitar. So why not attaching a learning offering to that first guitar? So we're currently speaking to two of the most biggest guitar retailers, or music instrument retailers, in the US and in Europe.
Sorry, I think my, can you still hear me? I think the battery just depleted. Rolling out a partnership early next year with two of the biggest guitar retailers in the world. Pricing points. So we have a 15 euro monthly subscription, 90 euro annual subscription. 90% of our users are on the annual track, basically. We have been quite active. So Fretello was part of Tim Cook's WWDC 19 keynote. So we are co-creating experiences like the augmented reality experience together with Apple. They're searching for use cases to run on mobile devices. There are not a lot of companies out there running real-time machine learning stuff on their microchips. So that's why we have a very good standpoint in terms of co-marketing opportunities. We have been app of the day in 150 countries across the globe, including the United States. We're featured at the moment in both US App Store and the Google Play Store. And we have quite some brand partnerships coming up. The most important one in Europe is probably Thomann, which is the biggest music retailer in Europe. But we also have partnerships with music publishers like Cobalt or in the past Sony TV. Quick look at the market. The music learning market is huge and it's growing exponentially. So our target market is Western musical instruments. So we're looking at a roughly $40 billion market. We decided to start with the guitar with the launch addressable market. So providing online guitar lessons, and only in the US, the market is $1.5 billion every year. Taking into account that a beginner spends four times as much money for music lessons than on the instrument itself. And in the US and in Europe, 40% of all music lessons are already consumed online. Yes, there are a few competitors. It may look crowded at first glance, but where we really stick apart is Fretello is the only musical learning experience that really takes into account the part of mastering the guitar. We don't teach you yet another trick. It's really about serious education, learning to play the musical instrument, and that's where we see already in terms of retention, we're outperforming even the biggest competitors on the market. Quickly jumping to the team, we're two co-founders, so it's Wolfgang and me. We both have an engineering background. Wolfgang, for example, was working in the Silicon Valley for NVIDIA, companies like Nokia. We founded our first business in 2014. We developed software for US-based action camera startup. And in 2016, we decided to follow our passion for lifelong learning and music making. Currently, or as of today, our team consists out of 27 people from 15 nations. So we're very widespread across the globe, with 50% of people working in software engineering, 27 in content production, and 23 in business operations and marketing. Yeah, brings me to our investment round. So we're currently raising our $2 to $3 million seed round with the goal to reach 250K MRR by the end of 2023. We already have 1.5 million hard commitment from one of the most active EdTech investors in Europe, which is SparkMind. And we also have some noteworthy investors already on board, including the founders of Fantastic, a sports app that sold to Adidas in 2015 for plus 200 million, the co-founders of Tractiv, who are joining the second closing, and CVC Capital partner Chris Lutmota. So we're doing a second closing until the beginning of next year. We already have 1 million in commitment for that round, and we're trying to fill the remaining gap with the help of you as the investors on the SeedBlink platform. So we're in particular looking for people who are ambitious about learning, about lifelong learning, about making education more accessible, and who are also, of course, in love with music. What we're going to do with the funds? First of all, we're extending our offering to not only be a mobile app, but also provide a web offering. So it doesn't matter which technology you're using to learn. We want to take the move to incorporate additional instruments like the piano or the drums. And we are going to uncover new markets. So we see extremely good potential in Eastern European and Asian markets with a strong demand, for example, coming in from Russia, Chinese, or also Japan. Yeah, that's basically it. Thanks for having me here, and I'm happy to answer any questions you may have.
All right, Florian, it's been a very nice presentation, and it's a very nice product that is easy to understand for each of us. Though I have a couple of questions first from my side, and one of them is referring to you as the founder. I know that you've been a talented music player, guitar player, actually, at the beginning, and probably you still are. You don't do it very, very much, but you still love it. And then you started computer science, and somehow you combined the two, and here we are with Fretello. The question is, why didn't you go to a corporation? Why didn't you build yourself a career? Because young people are doing this theoretically first, in the first 10 years, this is the theory. and then they gather some money and they gather some stability, and then they look at startups. What's different with you?
Yeah, so first of all, the idea for Fretello was born out of my own necessity. So I was a pretty bad guitar player in high school. And after university, I thought about selling all that stuff, but figured out with a good teacher, you can actually get far. And I was already studying computer science by that time. And I thought, like, hey, with all the capabilities and machine learning and smartphones we have, like, whatever I want to do in terms of teaching, I can do that with an app. So I can program an app that's basically doing the work of organizing my personal daily guitar workout. So that was my main intention why we started. The thing is, or how did we end up starting the business at first? So we had that opportunity to start a business for the US-based action camera startup because I did a student's project. So it was more like a coincidence that we actually started the company here. To earn some money on the side besides the studying program. And it turned out really successful. So we ended up with a whole bunch of revenues, which we then wanted to, like, instead of paying to ourselves, we thought, like, what can we do with the revenues we made in those 2 years? And we decided, hey, we have a good situation to bootstrap the initial idea of teaching people how to play a musical instrument. So we took the money we earned, we put it into the company, like in Fretello, and said, okay, let's try to use that money to actually bootstrap something which more like follows my passion to help others overcome the struggles I had. I mean, I almost quit. I almost sold all my guitar stuff because I really was frustrated. And I thought, like, even if we can help like 10% of those guitar players to not quit after 90 days, we are super successful because playing music is a whole lot of fun. And pre-COVID, like, I loved being on stage because it's just de-stressing, fulfilling. It adds so much more to the whole society. And I think there isn't a single person who does not at least consume music. And yeah, that's how we got there.
Yeah, it's very interesting because if I look back 20 years ago in Romania, whenever we made some money at the beginning, we just spent it. In a couple of days, we just threw it away. We just had good time. We had to acquire videos. We had to acquire a car and then an apartment and then everything. And we didn't develop a thing on those days. But now everything is different. And it's not that it's different, but only people that are doing it like you did are having success, because otherwise you cannot do it. You can't go and ask for the money from the beginning and show nothing and then ask people to trust you. So somehow this is the recipe, the good recipe to found the startup. Okay, some other question that I have refers to learning how to play, because if you take the guitar, in the beginning, you take it in your hands, there is a long process until you say, okay, now I know how to play it. And this whole process cannot be in your focus, because I think there are lots and different segments. A couple of years ago, I started to play piano, and I learned for 1.5 years. And only then I developed, and I saw how difficult it is. I mean, it's horrible. And if you don't study between the lessons, you don't do anything. You just go there with the teacher, you press some buttons, and that's it. So people have to study. And the question is, where are you implementing your software? In the study process, in the learning process, in at the beginning, at the end?
It's a very good question, and it's our main focus is to help beginners get started. So we're talking about casual musicians and serious musicians. And the difference is basically, after a beginner guitar player sticks around for 10 to 12 months, they're considered serious. They're not great, they're not intermediate, but they understand what it takes to learn. And that's how we approach it as well. So of course, first of all, you start learning some basic chords, some basic melodies. So it's a step-by-step learning process, and you have to practice. And that's one of our biggest USPs, where the technology comes into place. We have those licenses from music publishers. So we can teach you how to play Smoke on the Water, for example, but it's not like here's the song and play it. We're explaining techniques to you. We're using the songs as a sample to talk about rhythm, to talk about a little bit of music theory, but using actual music based on the user's goals. So we ask users, like, do you want to be a casual guitar player playing for yourself at home after work to de-stress? Or is your goal to play with friends in a band on a stage, for example? Based on that, we know how much it takes, where the users want to go, and we have those tailored curriculums with the new content. But after learning something new, you need to go to practice, and we have those practice plans. They are more like comparable to sports exercises, you know, doing your push-ups or crunches if you want to get a six-pack, so where you can come back daily. Based on what you learned, you do some technical training, some exercises, you apply that to real songs, and this is how we get the engagement of the users coming back. So of course you don't learn a new chord or a new technique every day. You have to practice what you learn. In the beginning, the learning curve is quite steep, so you can progress very, very fast. This slows down over time. That's where practicing becomes more and more important. And I think as of today, we roughly have 25,000 different exercise combinations available in the app. So it takes, an average user would need 24 years. So I did the math because I wanted to know how long it takes to do every single exercise myself. And this is like an effort from 15 to 20 minutes a day. You come there, do your exercises, you get better every day, you get feedback as you get better. And when you're ready, you continue on your learning journey. So we try to incorporate learning with practicing, and the practicing uses the technology and the algorithms to provide you with the feedback to show that there is actually progress.
Yeah. And having this in mind, what is your biggest challenge that you still have right now?
The biggest challenge is probably cutting through the noise. So what we see, and excuse my language here, is we see a lot of bullshit marketing, like competitors claiming that somebody can learn a musical instrument within 4 weeks or like a little effort, like as it's some kind of magic. The thing is, learning a musical instrument is no magic. And we are extremely successful being honest with our users. So we tell them, like, if you want to become a band player, then you have to commit a certain amount of time to exercise it. Being honest with the users, educating them what it takes, and will get you the best commitment from the users. Still, in terms of marketing, we have to cut through the noise to compete with the others, because at first glance, why is learning guitar in your app better than on YouTube? So we figured out that it only works through thought leadership, through participating in communications, being there, supporting the users, and building a community around the product. So that's probably the biggest challenge at the moment, because other companies, and they're not extremely successful with it, think it's just a matter of the size of the marketing budget you have to have available. But since like 6 months, we see more and more people flowing in from competitors, because being honest with our users and really helping them pays off in the end.
Yeah, this is interesting, because it's the same with us, because we are only in the market for the last 2 years, and we're still a startup somehow. And if you ask me what's my biggest challenge, I'm going to talk about customers. I'm going to talk about investors. I'm not going to talk about technical things. Although all of us are having technical issues, and it's not easy for us to put those in practice. But somehow, you know, you forget about technical issues, and you only talk about business issues, because more or less it's about customers. I'll ask Katerina when time will come about the same thing.
Yeah, because how can a customer trust you if there are others telling a similar story, and how do you cut through the noise? And this takes time, but it's solvable. So we see very good results with that strategy.
Yeah. Okay, we have two questions here. The first one, have you thought about selling the product to music schools or B2B players?
Selling to music schools, especially like, let's say in the German, Austrian area, is difficult, because they are owned by the government, basically. So we figured out we are more more successful talking to music teachers individually, like independent music teachers working with the teachers directly, who want to upsell their offering. So why should you go to a private teacher compared to sign up with a music school? However, just recently we entered a partnership with the Boys and Girls Club in the United States. So the Boys and Girls Club is the biggest charity with the vision to make education accessible for teenagers from troubled social levels, like people who can't afford proper education. So we're working on our concept here to bring music into education more prominently back to public schools. Public schools are cutting the budgets for music education, but everybody knows how important the proper music education system is. So we teamed up with them and with another partner, which is DW Trumps and the Trump Channel in the United States, to bring music education back to the schools. It doesn't require a huge budget. We get sponsors for that, like we even contribute the musical instruments. So we see a huge opportunity in partnering with schools.
Okay, because, you know, we barely see companies selling directly to customers being successful from the beginning. That's very difficult. We all the time see B2B companies, and then after B2B is all right, then they go to B2C. So somehow I'm sure that you thought about it as well. And you have to exploit all the resources that you have first with B2B.
The thing is, of course, we also have to focus as a startup. So we have the discussion whether to move into the B2C direction or the B2B. And the decision to go for B2C was simply because the demand for guitar lessons in the B2C, like people teaching themselves to play guitar, was much bigger. So 70% of all guitar players worldwide try to teach themselves before even looking for a guitar teacher. So that was the reason why we thought like the B2C market has the bigger initial opportunity.
Okay. I have another question here. Where does the name Fretello stem from?
it's an artificial creation. So it came together like the fret. The first part is, of course, like the fretboard of the guitar, and telling a story with the fretboard, like telling stories with music. So that was the idea behind it. We also thought like Fretello has a nice Italian touch, and a lot of the stuff in music comes from Fretello. So it was very charming for the beginning, but it's an artificial creation that somehow resonates with our vision to empower people to make music. So telling stories with the guitar. So that's how we created it and where it comes from.
It is like I was asking Bill Gates where Apple comes from. Okay, and the last one, on what factors do you make it depend to teach also other instruments? Is there a timeline for that?
Well, we are currently exploring in particular two different instruments. So the goal is within the next year to have an EdTech plan for at least one additional instrument. So we're currently exploring which instrument that will be. So closer looking at piano, but more recently also at the drum space, because there's not a lot of digital offerings available in the drum space, but the demand is huge. So we have been recently talking to big brands, including Red Bull, for example, who are looking into that space. And with the Trump Channel partnership already in place and connections to good drum teachers in the US, it's probably more likely that we are moving into the drum segment. Also knowing that I actually did not start with the guitar. I was a drummer before, so I learned to play drums at music school for 10 years or so before I picked up the guitar.
Okay, and the last one, how do you think your MRR will grow in the next 3-6 months?
We're currently focusing on scaling up with partnerships. And so the first partnership's rolling out at the beginning of the next year. So we plan to see, or we expect to see, step functions, because adding a subscription to every beginner guitar sold by a big retailer will significantly have an impact there. So within the next 3 to 6 months, let's say 6 months, we plan to be in the range of 70K MRR, so halfway through the next year's goal. So for the end of 2021, we plan to hit 150K MRR, which is basically the milestone we need to reach to be in place for Series A investment in the music or generally EdTech space.
Okay, and the last one from me. How do you see your exit? What are your plans? And after this, just give the investors two reasons to invest in Fretello.
Okay. M&A is very interesting, and the partnerships are one key there, because COVID situation showed more and more people try to sell guitars online. People don't go to music stores anymore. And the music retailers, like if we take Thomann, they're making $1.3 billion in revenue selling music instruments. But Fender, Gibson, they're doing the same. So why should you go for a Fender guitar or a Thomann guitar? So they need ways to differentiate themselves. So we see they have an increasing demand for digital products, but the partners are really good at selling guitars. They're not good or experienced in building digital products. So what we see with the partnerships already is that there's a symbiosis, because we can have a win-win situation. We get access to more customers, and at the same time, we help them upsell products that have pretty low margins, like the $200 guitars. We don't have a big margins here. So we think that one possible and promising M&A case would be partnering with the big retailers. And I mean, Thomann makes $1.3 billion revenue, Gibson is plus $3 billion, and that space is growing exponentially, especially in the Asian space. That's also first reason why people should invest in us. The market is going crazy. It's growing exponentially, and it was already growing exponentially pre-COVID. So people were always thinking, yeah, music making, like how can you earn money with music making or stuff? But numbers show the market is growing exponentially. There's a need for it. In Japan, for example, there's a guitar sold every 3 seconds. And like Japan is not the biggest country in the world. So that's probably one of the biggest reasons here. The second reason is we want to create an impact. Like we want to help people get a better education. Music education is impactful, and we found a way to be impactful, but at the same time earn money. So we're not talking about running a charity. And I think education is one of the most important goods we have on this planet. And if we can help the whole society evolve and at the same time earn money and grow substantially, that's a very good reason to invest in us as a company.
All right. Great, Florian. It's been great to listen to your presentation and to listen to your answers. I'll give the floor to Caterina now, and I wish